Hello and welcome to episode 5 of the One Game at a Time podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Seb O'Neill, joined by Mark Talbot. Mark, how are you going today?
I'm well, mate. How are you?
I'm doing quite well. Alessio Carocci, you also join us this podcast. How are you doing?
Very good, thanks, Seb.
And also joined by David Grant, our favourite man with an accent. How are you doing, David?
I'm very well, thanks. Although we all have accents, we're all beautiful in our own way.
But yours is different. That's what makes you special.
What's different to yours?
As always, we'll start with our picks of the week. I'll go first with the quite recent announcement that the Matildas will finally be coming back to play in Adelaide at Adelaide Oval against China on the 31st of May, which is, I think, one of their two farewell games just before they go off to the Olympics. So it's great to see the likes of Charlie Grant will most likely be in the squad, able to play at home, and Alex Chidiak being able to play back home at Adelaide in front of what will most likely be a sold-out Adelaide Oval. We'll go to you, Mark, to start on this one.
Yeah, this is the first time I heard this news, so that's great news from our government to get it hit back here in Adelaide. I'm assuming they played a big part in it because it's normally down to the governments in that realm. But no, great news. Great to have it back at Adelaide Oval as well. I think it will be a sellout. There's no two ways about it. I mean, the women's game's just absolutely skyrocketed off the back of the World Cup last year. So great news. Great to see the Adelaide girls back in Adelaide playing as well.
Yeah, equally excited about this. I took my daughters along the last time the Matildas were here, which I think was maybe 5 years ago.
And yeah, against Chile.
Yeah, I was about to say against Chile from memory. And it was a great experience. That game was at Hindmar. So, Coopers. A great atmosphere, you know, you're right down at the pitch. Adelaide Oval might lack a little bit of that. I suppose you can't get right down onto the pitch, obviously. But having said that, if we sell out Adelaide Oval, you can't knock it, can you? So yeah, super excited. Can't wait for it.
Yeah, agreed. I think it's going to be good as well to see if we can probably break some records for Matilda's games in Adelaide as well. And we've got Adelaide Oval with more seats. So it's going to be interesting to see as well. I don't think I have been since that 5 years ago one as well. And hopefully it just means more major games here in Adelaide. Even the men's, the Socceroos, I'd like to see more games here for them as well. Seeing a lot of their friendlies as well. We haven't seen many in Adelaide for a while. So be interesting to see.
Absolutely. And again, just the fact of the likes of players, especially Charlie Grant, who came throughout the system through the NTC program, came from Cumberland, played in the WNPL to now be a Matilda and being able to have that experience of playing Adelaide Oval will be amazing. Now Tottenham player even as well.
It's great that
she plays for Tottenham?
No, not at all. It's great that she's taken those steps. But literally, it's all been SA and a major step. She obviously made a big step over, I think, Sweden. She was playing with Gorrie over there. And then the likes of the almost big club in Tottenham picking her up. You can tell that I'm an Arsenal supporter, it's great that the more Aussies we get in the Women's Super League, the better off, regardless of what team they're playing in. The more of our girls we can get there playing, the better. So it's great that she's at Tottenham. It would have been better if she was at the Arsenal with the rest of the Arsenal squad, the Adelaide Australia squad, but can't win them all. So
I think I saw it. Didn't Tottenham beat Arsenal in the North London Derby of the women's for the first time ever?
Saw that crowd too.
We just beat them last night 1-0 at the Emirates with the largest, it was second largest crowd in the WSL. So Arsenal hold the record at the moment. When they played United, they had the largest crowd, and then we played Tottenham overnight and we have the second largest crowd on record. So they both played them at the Emirates. So it's 50,050, I think it was last night for the 1-0 win. So, and then the United game, I think it was 52,000 or something. So the Arsenal, to be fair, the Arsenal are blitzing with crowds because they're playing a lot of their games at the Emirates and people are just buying tickets and going. So,
but still not enough to be at the top of the WSL table, Mark. Alessio, we'll go on to you with Fulham United. You want to talk about them again. What about in particular this time?
Well, finally, they've got a win and there are some quite pleasing goals on the eye as well. From the ones that I watched as well. Great headers, great finishes as well, clinical inside the box, super subs coming on and scoring it with instant impact as well. And against the major team, we talked about this previously, Cobras versus Fulham, these are probably two title contenders, at least in my opinion, or at least both of them will be top three this season. And a 3-0 thumping at home at the West Beach is a massive statement to put out in the first week, especially with, I think they might have been runners-up last year, Cobras, in the or maybe third. Two losses to start off their season is massive, both against players teams that are going to be in the same spots as them this season. It's not a good look for them so far.
No, certainly not a good look for Cobras. Fulham were, we'll pick them to be sort of, well, I picked them to be sort of top six in finals and things like that. But I think they're sort of exceeding my expectations at the moment. But a 3-0 win, it's a big statement win. Alessio, you called it last week that you said they might win. Being at West Beach, it's always hard to go play at West Beach. And it's certainly proving the case at the moment. But Dan Godley rolling back the years in goal as well. Made some great saves from what I hear. I'm going to watch back the highlights this week. But great to see him back in between the sticks. And obviously, he's sorted the back line out. They conceded a few goals last year. This year, they seem quite sound. But I actually think the reason Alessio keeps mentioning him is he wants to play for them. So I'm wondering if that's a subtle hint to Robbie there to say, hey, Robbie, you need to keep an eye on this guy from Barker. He wants to play for Fulham.
No, I don't want to train there again every couple of days. That was a tough place to train during the week. Especially, I remember there was a few times, I think it's in the winter when it gets foggy, you can't even see the other half of the pitch. You can't even see who's training on the other half. But I'm happy with my facilities at the moment.
Still not a definite no, but we'll go on to David, who wants to talk about South Australians playing over in Scotland.
Yeah, so we had two South Australians playing against each other yesterday. So Livingston were travelled up to Perth to play St Johnstone up there. Livingston featuring Wantete Yenge, formerly of the Adelaide Comets, and of course St Johnstone having Ryan McGowan. So they would have been playing right on each other. McGowan was one of the centre pairings at the back, and Tete Yenge was deployed as the sole striker for Livingston. Game finished 1-1. Yenge didn't score, so I guess that's a bit unusual in itself, the way he's been going recently. It was a game that Livingston really needed to win. They're sitting bottom of that Scottish Premiership table. But yeah, great to see two South Australians playing in the Premier League in Scotland, and interesting to see them playing against each other. The other thing I was going to mention is that we were at Parahills Knights on Friday night, which of course is Ryan McGowan's former club. And above the bar there, they've got a Heart of Midlothian jersey, which obviously had been donated by Ryan McGowan. He's not at Hearts now, and he hasn't been there for several years, so he's not updated the shirts for them. But yeah, that was my little pick of the week for you.
Did you try out Scottish John's barbecue in the end?
No, I didn't. So the story behind that for the listeners who maybe didn't catch the game on Friday is that there was a big sign saying Scottish John's barbecue at Parahills Knights. He was a bit late, Scottish John, in turning up. So one of his apprentices was deep frying everything for him on his behalf. He turned up a bit later on, but I didn't get to chat to him. He was very busy, seems to be a very sociable kind of guy. So he was off chatting to others by the time we got over there. I think the barbecue had been closed as well. But I didn't try anything.
Quite friendly and chattable for a Scottish. That doesn't sound right.
Mark, on to you. You want to talk about the amount of goals being scored all across the league. It's quite extraordinary.
We've had two rounds and you look at some of the results and there's been a lot of goals, like a lot. We've had a few 5-0s. We've had like, what do we have, a 4-3 with Metro and Raiders on the weekend alone. White's FK Big rate of 5-1 over Olympics. So there seems to be a lot of goals. So either the strikers are getting really good or the defence is starting to really taper off and become not as strong as what it used to be. I don't know. But there just seems to be a lot of goals in games.
I did hear recently Alessio is now in the back line for Barker, so maybe that's that's attributing to it.
But you know what I'm saying? Like when you look at it, I have to go back through last year just for the first two rounds because I don't reckon there was this many goals scored in the first two rounds last year. It just seemed like a lot of goals. Like I said, I just don't know if it's the defense are getting worse or the strikers are getting better. Maybe something we need to keep an eye on.
Yeah, well, I think definitely some of the goals we've seen this weekend as well. Like we're just talking about in our chat, how many you're going to have to cull down for goal of the week because there's so many good ones. So I think it is going to be a contributing factor how how spectacular some of these goals are. Like, I don't know if even you could pick some of these free kicks out of the top corners, Mark. But
oh, no chance. I've seen some of them just like, nah. That one that's at the old Enfield ground for
Adelaide Victory, yeah.
I don't think anyone's saving that one. Not unless you're hanging from that spot in the goal post, the crossbar, that's for sure.
Couple of volleys as well, you know, possible to get near them.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I said from a defensive, not have bagging the goalkeepers, I'm bagging the defense more than the defenders, than the goalies, that's for sure. Some of the keepers got no chance, but sometimes you sort of got to wonder, is the defense shutting the shots down or are they letting them shoot? Who knows? But there just seems to be more than usual, like more goals than what I would expect.
I've just had a quick flick through each of the leagues, and I can tell you that Adelaide Comets are the only club whose first team have not conceded a goal. So every other club in every other division, so NPL, State League 1, State League 2, every club's conceded at least one goal, and most clubs have conceded 4-5 goals in the two games or the two rounds that we've played, Comets being the only club that have not conceded. So I don't know, I'm guessing maybe leaky defences, poor defending.
I'd love to say that's the case, but I don't want to cause a rift or anything like that with anyone I know. So
I'm just saying what the stats say.
Exactly, that's why I'm happy to go with it. Only with the stats. I'm not saying there's anything else in it.
But you think, you know, we're only two games in, and yet every team bar the Comets has conceded at least one goal, and most have conceded, I'm just glancing through it, most have conceded 4 or 5 in two games.
How about the red cards as well? A couple of keepers being sent off, a couple of, well, I think there's maybe 3 red cards this week across the leagues, possibly 4.
I've seen 2, Woodlands and John Mbembe at Adelaide United.
Yeah, there's definitely 2 in the NPL. In the state leagues, I think there was quite a few as well. I know there's one for Western Strikers, one for Seaford, one for Adelaide Uni. I think that's all I've seen. But yeah, I think it was something that happened last year as well, though. There was quite a few reds early on in the season. Let's see if I can find any more. No, looks like that's it. Maybe 3 in each league or 2, about 2 in each league.
Well, speaking of goals, we had plenty of them this past round. Starting on Friday night, we had one game in State League 2 between Eastern United and Port Adelaide, which ended 3-1. At the Paddocks, we had Parry Hills Knights defeated by Adelaide City 3-2 with a late goal. And then, as we said, Adelaide Comets not conceding for a second game in a row, 5-0 winners over South Adelaide. What are your thoughts, gents, on those ones?
Well, I think it might have been Mark who picked... Was it, or maybe David, who picked Eastern to win at home against Pirates? Probably wasn't Mark because he always goes for the Pirates. But
yeah, I went with my heart and set a draw on that one.
Yeah, I think I might have. I can't remember, but anyway, it was an unbelievable ending to that game as well. It's one of the only State League 2 games that gets live streamed as well. So I tuned in for the last couple, and there was some screamer goals in there as well. Possibly some poor defending, or even. Definitely goalkeeping on that one. But, yeah, a couple of late goals. I think it was 11 minutes added time, and it was 1-1 locked at that stage, and the centre-back scores from the halfway line, and then they score another one on the break near the end. And a big win for Eastern United as well. They had a poor start in the first round, 4-0 loss against Ponte, and so to bounce back like that, front of your home as well, Friday night to Eastern, I think that's going to be a major fixture in the State League 2 this season.
Yeah, 96 and 101st minute for 2 goals. Very, very late. And that was funny enough after sending off to Pirates as well in the 88th minute.
There's another one, yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah, very late show for Eastern on Friday night. Yeah, they stream their own games via their Eastern United YouTube channel, which is great for those that don't get out there to watch. But, yeah, look, we expected, we knew it would be a close game, and effectively it was a close game right up until the dying embers of the game, really. So, it'll be tough for Port to bounce back from that one. It's not easy conceding when you push such late goals, so they're going to have to bounce back this week. But Eastern got their season off started now, and be interesting to see how they continue. Like I said, we've all picked them to go quite well this year, so be interesting to see how they now pick up the form and run with it.
And of course, there were those two MPL games for that Friday night, the game at the Paddocks and the game at South Adelaide. Three of us were at the Para Hills game and Adelaide City game. Alessio and David were your main voices for that one. Between you two, how do you think it went?
I think it went quite well. David got the pick of the bunch this weekend. Two of the best games of the week went to him as a co-commentator. Otherwise, it was a very big surprise for Para Hills that they put up that much of a show against the powerhouse like Adelaide City. And I definitely don't think that they let them have as much freedom in the game as many would have expected. It was good to see some new faces as well for both sides that I haven't seen in the first round. The new captain for Para Hills, Diego de Oliveira, he was quite good from what we saw. He ran the show and probably had a hand in both the goals they scored near the end. But it was the new signings for Adelaide City. All three of them on the score sheet yet again. Akot, Abichu, and Arok. All three of them getting their names back on the score sheet. Late winner from the centre-back as well. It was a good showing, I think. Two tactical attempts at the game as well from both sides. I remember seeing Para Hills get really defensive when it was 2-1 and hope for a lucky break. Maybe even when it was 2-2, I can't remember. But when they got back into the game and it opened up again, and Adelaide City had some chances themselves, and it was from another set piece where Arok scores again. He scored from a free kick last week and from a corner this week.
Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was my first game of the year, so it was good to get back into it. And Les covered it all pretty well there at Para Hills Knights. Just maybe a little bit unlucky. I think Adelaide City were probably the better of the two sides, but Para Hills Knights will be disappointed not to have got something out of the game. I think De Oliveira was probably one of their best. I would agree with you on that as well. He was a standout, wasn't he? Yeah, nothing more to add, really.
And then down south, two teams on sort of opposite ends already of their season, a team who hasn't conceded any and scored quite a few, whereas South Adelaide haven't scored one and conceded nine in their first two games. Mark, as somewhat of a local, what do you make of this for South Adelaide in particular?
Well, I was actually there for the first part of the game, and then I left and watched the rest of it once I got home. But look, South's struggled the first two games, but they are missing JJ right out, which is a big loss for them. Just his ability to attract so many different players in the back lines of other teams just creates space for others. And we know that he's a good finisher. So when you're lacking JJ in any team, you're really going to miss him, and they do. Unfortunately, he's in a moon boot at the moment. He's got tests tomorrow. They're hoping he'll be somewhat ready for this weekend. They just have to wait and see how fitness tests go tomorrow. But he blew out his ankle just before the last Thursday before round one training. So like I said, I caught up with him on Friday night in a moon boot. Very positive though. He's still upbeat. He's just hanging to get back. He was ready to come back straight away, but doctors have said, "Nah, look, you need to. you can't just yet." So he's hoping he'll be back this week. If not, I dare say they may rest him for the cup, because the cup round obviously is coming up, I think not this weekend, but weekend after. So they'll probably look to rest him for the cup and make sure he's ready for round four, is my guess. But yeah, he's ready to go as far as he's concerned. He's ready to play, but we'll just have to, they'll have to wait and see. But Comets, mate, they're just business as usual for them, almost rolling back the years, actually, to be honest. They look pretty impressive. We've got a star-studded lineup, and they've added a goal scorer, a proper goal scorer. I'm not saying Welsh isn't a goal scorer, because Welsh is, but he's also a utility player. He can play in the middle of the park, he can play centre-back. You could probably put him in goal and he'll do you a job. They've got Garrido now, who, as we know, he's banged about 60-something goals in two Tassie MPL seasons, so he knows with the back of net, and he's already started showing that. So I think with him this year, they're going to be I think I've got him making the top six, but I think in about sort of fourth or fifth. But they could be a dark horse, I think, if they keep their players fit and with the lineup they've got. They could have a big season. And the other thing is Lewis Moss as well got injured during the game. So young Jude Humans came in for him. So a big day for him. So he hasn't played a lot of games, so it's always tough playing on a Friday night coming in against Comets. So I'm not saying he played badly, but it's not easy for a young keeper to come into that situation. Already down 2-0 by that stage, it's not easy to come in and then and rescue and try and people comments out, but he did overall, he didn't do too badly. So, but we'll just have to wait and see how long Moss is out for.
I thought I'd ask as well. I'm not sure if you had any intel, but they signed Clement Wakoci in the off season.
Yeah, they I haven't seen him out at all though.
Yeah, maybe it's a move that elsewhere that happened in the off season. But I thought he was one to look forward to as well. If they had him, hopefully he's not injured as well. But it's another big miss, as you said, in the attacking lineup. But they have got some star players as well. You got Tyrese Conway. You got Alex Wright out as well. So they're not. They definitely. Yeah, they have enough. But
yeah, they've got the players there. It's just making it sort of fit and jog. So obviously they've got a few new players as well, like Tyrese and Akiri Kobayashi, who's great player. So just to get them to gel and so just got to find the right way to get them to tick over and gel and those types of things. So it'll be interesting to see how they go. I think they had a bit of a they started off really well last year, sort of around 3 and 4, and then after they went on a bit of a downward hill a little bit, plateaued a little bit. So maybe trying to think of ways around that so they don't plateau for 8 games and then have to pick themselves back up. Hopefully try and sort of stay a little bit at higher level. But it'll be interesting to see how they pull up and go moving forward. Like I said, JJ to come back. And once he comes back, that those players like Tyrese and Alex have someone to hit as a target man. And I said, hopefully we can get the goals for them.
I just had a quick look at the table again. Each of the tables in South Adelaide are the only team that haven't scored yet. So as much as Comets haven't conceded, South Adelaide are the only club in the NPL, State League 1 and State League 2 that haven't scored yet. Just thought I'd chuck that one in for you too.
Love it, yeah.
I've just seen as well some pictures of Clement that he was there on the media day for South Adelaide. Yeah. So I assume he must be coming back from an injury as well.
I'll just chat. See, I'll get down there. Actually, I'm there tomorrow night. So Tuesday night, I'm actually there for my lads training, and the seniors obviously train Tuesday night. So I'll find out and hopefully have an update for you. If he's not playing this weekend, I'll have an update for you for next week.
Yeah, because he is another big goal scorer as well. You saw what he did at Raiders, at Blue Eagles in the past few seasons. I think he might have been almost one of the top scorers before he moved from Raiders to Blue Eagles. I think it was 2022 season or maybe 23, but yeah, it'd be a big in if they can get him while JJ's coming back as well. It's two major strikers that are proven goal scorers.
Moving on to Saturday in State League 2, we had 5 games go on, starting with a 2-2 draw between Northern Demons and Pontian Eagles, a 2-1 win for Adelaide Uni over Noarlunga United, a 5-1 win for Mobury Vista over Adelaide Hills Hawk, a 4-0 win for Seaford over Gawler Eagles, and a 1-3 loss to Mount Barker United. But congratulations, Alessio, first goal.
Yeah, it wasn't mine, but we did score a goal. And it was, a bit of a depleted side, so it was quite unfortunate that we couldn't get a better result against them. They were missing Matt Canny, they were missing Oliver Grant, Jared Daly, Mitch Keynes, and they had a starting lineup that was a bit different from the one we played in the Cup, at least. But that man Foglier again just finds the net so much ease. I think he scored 4 goals in 2 games against us now. So he's definitely the danger man. But we were looking better. We changed formation again during the game. So it might be interesting to see how that goes going forward. But otherwise, the results around the grounds, we can't just focus on us. Adelaide Uni coming very close with Noarlunga, which is very interesting to see. We all tipped those two to be the opposite ends of the spectrum this season. Adelaide Uni went down to 10 men. Sam Bowman getting sent off. We actually have Adelaide Uni this weekend, so them doing without a striker might be handy for us. Didn't work this week, but maybe in the next it will. But other than that, there was a partially suspended game between Seaford and Gawler, which is now the results going back to Seaford because it was past the 75th minute. But it was interesting to see as well because Seaford got a player sent off just after half time as well, and they still managed to score a fourth with 10. And from all accounts, the reason the game was postponed could have led them to go down to another man less, but still to be 4-0 up in a game that there were so many cards and stuff like that really shows, as we were saying, whichever team can get the win out of those two, that's almost a relegation 6-pointer or a 6-pointer between the two during the season.
Yeah, look, I think Northern Demons, Queensland Eagles. I think that's, I had Northern Demons to win there, being at home, but bit of a surprise there for Ponsons. I didn't think they'd cope as well on a larger pitch on the artificial, and they've, and not, as we know, Northern Demons got a big win the week before, 6-1 win the week before. So I think that's a great result for Pontians, actually going up there, getting a draw, like I said, larger pitch, artificial pitch. And obviously with the travel, I think it's a great result for Pontians. And to be honest, I think a few of us had them quite low down the table, but they're, at the moment, I think they're a bit of a surprise package and surprising a lot of teams with their results. The only other game, I think, Modbury Vista, Hills Hawks, I think we all picked Modbury, but I didn't think they'd probably win by as many. A 5-1 win there, but overall, wasn't a surprise that they got the victory. I think Hills are just going to struggle, unfortunately. So,
otherwise, around in State League 2, there's going to be some more games this week, and we're going to have to see if any of them get postponed or pushed back as well. Might alter some of the grounds or some of the conditions that they're played at as well. So it's going to be good looks for this weekend.
On to State League 1. Had 6 games on the Saturday. A 3-2 win for Adelaide Victory over West Torrens Burkala with, as you said, a great free kick there. Playford 2-0 winners over Cumberland United. Fulham, as we already spoke about, 3-0 winners over Adelaide Ammonia Cobras. A 1-1 draw between Salisbury United and West Adelaide. Western Strikers coming out 1-0 winners away to Vipers FC, and Adelaide Blue Eagles coming out 3-0 winners against...
I think for me, a couple of games stand out. Salisbury, West Adelaide, I think that's a great result for Salisbury. We all picked West Adelaide to be up there, sort of towards the top of the table, but Salisbury been great so far. A win and a draw in their first 2 games, both at home. But yeah, great result for them. The other game that I know a little bit about, I actually caught up with Rudgie from Cumberland, Cumberland are missing quite a few players at the moment in their lineup. I know that they were missing Wooding, Rudge. I think they were also missing the Sean defender, who's normally captain as well. I think they were missing Harley Jepp as well. So there's 4 players from starting 11 missing this week. So I think Playford got them really at the right time to beat them. I think it would have been a lot different of a game if those 4 were playing. So I think Playford got them at the right time for the year for that win.
Yeah, I think it's also interesting. Obviously, an ex-Salisbury player in our team, Anthony Taylor, was letting us know. I think Salisbury may be undefeated in about 15 games at home.
Yep.
That goes back past the final series and during the season last year. He couldn't even remember the last time they lost there, but it's quite becoming quite a fortress as well. And I remember a lot of teams, they like to have that in some of their preseason objectives or team goals as well. Stay undefeated at home or make sure nobody defeats you by a lot at home, stuff like that. So maybe that's one of their team goals, and it's working out so far. The other game I saw some highlights from was the Sturt versus Blue Eagles game, where it just seemed like they cleared their lines, Sturt lines, but seemed like at least from 2 of the goals, they were straight to Blue Eagles players, and they just had shots from outside the box, found the bottom corner really nicely. Of course, our man Dante is the catcher, Villani, scoring from a corner, a bullet header. Otherwise, Sturt, I don't think, had as many chances as they'd hoped as well. I don't think they were missing anyone either, but that's another top team in the State League 1 that we're all expecting, Blue Eagles. And I think a few people expected Sturt to be in the top 6 as well. So it's a commanding win for a title contender.
Yeah, the Salisbury United, just to go back to them, they're obviously carrying that form from last year into this year. I can't remember what we said at the start of the year, the very start with our predictions, but they might be on track for back-to-back promotions. The other result that I wanted to mention as well was West Adelaide. They drew again, so it was a game I kind of thought they might have picked points up in. I think they play Western Strikers next round, so they're going to have to start picking up points. So they'll be backs against the wall for the first half of the season, trying to avoid those relegation spots.
On to the rest of the MPL fixtures for Saturday, starting with what was a surprising 1-0 win for Croydon after Campbelltown had Alex Woodland sent off. And before anyone comes in on this, I have been sent a special audio message from someone that I've been asked to show to you. So we'll have a listen now.
Hey all, I wish I could have been there this week because a bit of bragging to do. Earlier in the season, I predicted Croydon to win the league and you guys gave it to me hard. Well, look, they beat Campbelltown on the weekend. I haven't beaten them in a while and they did it. In Dodd we trust. Never doubt me, boys. Never doubt me. I'm looking forward to seeing how they go and got to take the wins when you can. And I'm taking, I'm giving it back to you this week. Never doubt me. I wish I could have been there tonight to say it in person. But as you know, I'm watching Neighbours. So, boys, good episode tonight. And I hope you boys have an even better episode. I'll see you all soon. Go, Croydon.
Like, we're haunted by him. You just can't get away from him, can you? He's just everywhere.
So, yeah, any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, look, as much as I like to take Johnny's predictions, I still can't see them that high in the table coming into the season. Yes, they did beat Campbelltown, who we've all predicted will finish top. I think we've all predicted them to finish top. But they did go down to 10 men. They still had their chances, Campbelltown. And they were down to 10 men early on with, obviously, Woodland's getting sent off. I think it was the 15th minute. Clear foul, clear penalty, clear sending off. Came out and took the striker before he could do anything else. So, yeah, look, I don't think, like I said, I don't see Croydon still finishing as high as what Johnny reckons. But overall, great result. I mean, you've still got to play hard. You've still got to play against 10 men, and it's never easy playing against 10 men. They always seem to have extra players, even though they're a man down. So it's fascinating that. I think the keeper was unlucky. On the goal, he came out for a punch, didn't hit it prop, didn't punch it at all very well. And Carl with a great, Andre Carl with a great finish, overhead kick from inside the box. But yeah, look, I think overall, Croydon take the 3 points and run for sure. I mean, I think going back to Woodcock Reserve later in the year is going to be a different task if they keep 11 players on the park. But like I said, you've got to play, you can only play what's in front of you. They play with, they had to play against 10 men. They got the win. They take 3 points. And it kicks their season off for what hopefully for them will make them finish in top five or top six, whatever finals are.
Or top two, according to Johnny.
Or top two, according to Johnny. He's busy filming his own show anyway.
It was an upset, wasn't it? I mean, I don't think any of us would have picked that. I think when we did our little predictions last weekend, we all backed Campbelltown. So definitely an upset. But that's the beauty of this game. You know, it doesn't matter if you're the team at the bottom of the table. In this game, you can still beat any team in that league on your day. And if they're having an off day, your chances are doubled. You don't get that in many other sports. So well done to them. But I agree with you, Mark. I think when it comes to the return leg, I don't think it'll be a repeat. I think Campbelltown will get... The players will have been getting an absolute rollicking this week for that, and they'll bounce back next week. I think they play Metro Stars this weekend, so they'll bounce back from that. And I would say, well done, Croydon, but it's probably not going to happen next time.
And what a goal as well from Andre Carl, the bicycle kick. The cameraman just about caught it as well. I think it might have been a mistake from the keeper who came in for Alex Woodlands, but... Lucky the cameraman probably saved him his blushes to watch that back. But Andre Carl, the leading marksman at the moment for Croydon and probably the league as well. A lot of us predicted Anthony Costa to be the leading goal scorer in this season, but he's yet to make an appearance. And Andre Carl is one of the ones leading the race to get ahead of him so far, as well as those new signings for Adelaide City as well. So it's going to be interesting to see what they can do. And sometimes all you need is a big goal scorer and that will push you up the table.
Two Jeps Cross, where we had the grand final rematch between Adelaide United and Mowbray Jets. Of course, Adelaide United with a almost completely different side to last year, but Mowbray Jets getting their revenge on Adelaide United. 5-1 winners. Adelaide ended up going down to 10 men as well with a send-off to Jean-Paul Mbembe. it's hard because I guess what do we think of Adelaide United? I know it's a very young squad, and Mark, you said the week before how you said one of their standouts was the young Amlani Tattoo. What do we think of United this season?
Yeah, look, they seem to be in that transition year where it happens to them every second year. All the new faces, the younger kids come through, and it'll take them a year to get used to it because most of these players will still be there next year. They like to tell them they're a Porter, Tattoo. I mean, you had Luke Bazell playing in the side on the weekend. He's the only sort of senior, and Panache Madana are the two real senior players there. But yeah, I think they're in that transition year. They'll still play the same way. They'll still try and play the football that they need to play, that Ayrton works tirelessly to implement and have them progress through so that they can jump into the senior side, or should I say the A-League side, and still be able to play the same way. But yeah, I think they're in that transition. I mean, you look at past their goalkeepers, yes, they've sold the two keepers this year. But when you look at it, I mean, they had Oscar Page, who's only a young keeper still. He was sent off last week. They brought in Noah Ilol this week, who I believe is only 15, maybe 16, but he's been representing the Aussies at 14s and 15s, I think it is, and he's one of the best keeper at those tournaments. So they're just a really young side, really young. So I think it might be that transition year for them, unfortunately, where they're going to – it'll be a tough year for them. They may get some of the players back from the A-League that aren't playing at the moment, but that will be here and there maybe. But yeah, I think it's a bit of a transition year for them. And like I said, these players next year will probably benefit and will probably again go quite well next year. But it's still early for them. They've got plenty of time to turn their season around. So I wouldn't put too much on it just yet.
It's going to be a tough year, and you're going to have to see which players can shine in amongst adversity. And you're going to see which players can do what they can with the opportunities they're given. And hopefully we see some standouts come through.
Yeah, not much to add myself other than Hamish McCabe hat-trick, right? He must be the league's top scorer or thereabouts now. So he's got 3 goals in that one game. He scored more goals than some of the other clubs in the comp, hasn't he?
Yeah, and some certain clubs in State League 2 as well.
Yeah.
Over to TK Shutter Reserve, where David, we were at probably what ended up being the game of the round in terms of a scoreline and just a game, 4-3 in the end, a late winner coming from Cameron Woodfin. And in the end, what after review, what might have been a offside goal from Ren Nagamatsu?
Yeah, thanks to our local VAR eagle-eyed commentator, Alessio.
Yeah, I posted it on Twitter and had some interesting comments as well. I think most people expected it to be called as well. I was just very surprised that the Lions person didn't even see that he was coming from an offside position from getting up off the floor. So surely you pay attention to that when he comes back into the play. But otherwise, some cracking goals in that game as well. And he's lucky he did stay onside to, in his mind, to turn around and smack that one into the back of the net. A fantastic through ball inadvertently from Bradley Corbo as well. It's got to be one of the assists of the weekend, at least. If Irabona got the one last week, that interception, slide tackle type ball in behind to Mateo was fantastic and got them right back into the game. Frank Brassasa as well with that left foot strike sent the crowd into raptures on that near side as well where the Raiders box was. But otherwise, as some of their players mentioned to me as well, it's just a positive sign to show that they can come up against a team like Metro Stars, given that much of a game in one of their first seasons back in the NPL.
I think that was exactly one of the things we said right after the game, David, was that in our post-game chat, we said that it shows that Raiders can definitely compete at this level, especially with a scoreline like that.
Yeah, they certainly weren't outclassed, were they? I mean, I think Metro Stars were the better side on the day, and I think the statistics backed that up as well.
Half-time, but they only had one shot, Raiders.
Yeah, that's right. And that's the shot they obviously scored from because they scored about 10 minutes in, didn't they? That sort of rattled Metro Stars a little bit, who sort of kicked into action. Cittadini's scored one back in the 18th minute. And then Ren Nagamatsu, I think it was the penalty first, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then just at the end there, so it's one of those games where the scores bounce back and forth, you know, a 2-1-0 1-1, 2-1, 2-all, whatever, you know, the score just bounced back and forth. And then Woodfin's goal scored right at the, with pretty much almost the last kick of the game. I think the Croatia Raiders were appealing for offside, but I think there was a player on the post. So
I did look back at it.
Yeah, yeah, there was a player on the post, so no offside. And a revelation for me, Cameron Woodfin's American. Cameron Woodfin's American, I never knew until you told me, Seb. I've only been watching him for 2 years.
Yeah, you also found out that Callum Campbell is Scottish as well.
Yeah, I looked him up after. He's from Glasgow, apparently, but he must have been a youngster when he came out here, because I think he's been here for a wee while.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
He really impressed me, that Callum.
Yeah, he...
really impressed with what I saw of the game. He just seemed to be popping up everywhere. I was really impressed.
Yeah, he worked really hard. I don't forget that, you know, it was a warm day as well. They're out there in the sun running around, and it's a warm day, and he was very industrious. He worked really hard. So, yeah, he was probably among my top three of the Croatia Raiders side, you know. Did well. And he's only about 19 or something.
Man of the match as well. On their Instagram, they posted he got their fans man of the match as well. Playing that false nine role as well. Maybe Anthony Costa is going to have some struggle getting back into the side.
If they're playing a false nine, certainly will do. Just quickly, while I had it, Garrido scored the first week and scored two this week. So he's on three as well, with Hamish McCabe as leading goal scorers. Well, if no one else has got more than three, which I don't think they have. So, however, actually, yes, Sebastian Good. Did he not get a hat-trick this weekend?
Yeah, he did, yeah.
So there's three on three.
Speaking of that hat-trick, we'll go on to that game, which I think last week...
That was.
I know, exactly, right? which I think we all said last week was going to end either 0-0 or a 1-0, but ended up being just a thrashing in favour of FK Belgrade.
Good thing Johnny's not here for this one, because I think he went and had food there, I think, as per usual. But yeah, look, great result for FK Belgrade. Great result. Coming off the loss to Metro, again, as we said, they didn't start till 10 minutes late that game. This game, they've come out straight off the bat, scored in the 16th minute, and effectively there was no looking back for them once they'd scored that first one. They then scored another 20 minutes later, and then they scored again 52 minutes in. So Olympic really not at the races in that game at all, didn't have much of a chance, And like I said, the other good thing, as we said, Sebastian Good with a hat trick, but I don't know if anyone saw it, but the Craig Shearer goal in the 93rd minute, he's come on. He came on 77th minute. I think it was probably one of his only shots on goal he had. And I tell you what a finish it was as well. I don't know if you get a chance to have a look at it. He's just picked out his spot from about 20 yards out, left foot curled at top corner. And I was like, man, that's a good finish. And that's what I keep hearing, is that he's a proper finisher. And when I saw that, like that's a good finisher's goal. Like he's just picked it up 20 yards out, and he's just picked his spot and good night, sweetheart, basically. But following on, Olympic, I think, are going to struggle more than what I thought they would. That's two results now not going their way. And yeah, I mean, 5-1 to a club who I thought was going to be somewhere around them. At the start of the year, I thought there'd be sort of them, Olympic, FKB, Great Olympic, coring in that sort of pool just outside, or just trying to push that six. Be beaten 5-1 by one of those teams. Not a good sign for Olympic. Hopefully, I hope they can do stuff to get out of it and rectify whatever they need to down there. But just have to wait and see.
Yeah, I think originally when we did our predictions at the start, we all had our doubts as to how well Olympic would do this year, and it's a shame to see them so comprehensively beaten. But they were facing a side that had obviously learned a lesson from round one, and that lesson was be on your toes, boys, right from the first whistle. So Beograd have obviously come out, learnt from that, and poor old Olympic have just been in the end of a bit of a hiding as a result of that. So. Yes, sorry to see such a big scoreline in that, but that's just the game, isn't it? So hopefully Olympic can bounce back next week.
I think I was the one that predicted that it was going to be a Beograd win last week. I thought they would have it back in them. It's a great win for them as well. I could see some of the pictures that Antonis took as well, how much the crowd was enjoying that as well. And it's good to see as well some players from last week who probably had poor performances for Beograd get their confidence back and really show what they're worth in the starting 11. So it's good to see.
And before we move on, Seb, just want to say what a good showing the club itself of Olympic put on that Saturday night. Massive crowd. One thing they do well is they get their sponsors and their juniors down for their sponsors and junior night. Put on a great show for their sponsors. Unfortunately, it wasn't so on the pitch, but off the pitch, great show for their sponsors and getting their juniors around and really promoting the club, which is great. Like I said, they pulled in a massive crowd from what Johnny was saying and what you could see on the TV, so which was great.
Absolutely. That's all the results from round two of this past weekend. We'll go on to this week's upcoming fixtures, starting with on the Friday night, our first competitive WMPL game, the WMPL Preseason Cup Final between Adelaide Comets and West Adelaide. We'll do our predictions for all of these games coming up. Who do we think will come on top of this one between Adelaide Comets and West Adelaide? Both teams with a lot of good pickups.
I'll say this one. I reckon that it's going to be Comets. I reckon they're going to get their first trophy back in and amongst it as well. They've had some good results in preseason. I think Campbelltown's definitely a big surprise to see them right up there as well. They made some good signings as well. I think they signed Regan as well. So it's going to be interesting to see what they can do as well in a big final like that. I haven't seen them in there for a long time. But I'm going to give it to Comets. They're kicking all the right goals at the moment. And I reckon it's going to be the first one to bring home to Ellis Park.
I think I'm going to have to go against you, Alessio. You say West Adelaide, I think. They got some great players back in. Griggs is back playing this year again. And I know we all know how good a player she is. So I'm going to have to go West Adelaide. I think their experience in these situations is just going to tell and be enough for them this year.
I'm going to go with you, Alessio. I'm going to say Adelaide Comets. Some impressive results through the previous rounds, albeit maybe against sides that are a wee bit lesser fancied. And they played Salisbury Inter in the semi-final last week and it went to penalties, I believe. But I'm going to go Comets. It's very early in the season. It's very early in the season, isn't it? There's no form, is there? So it's hard to predict. It was the same when we did when we were sort of trying to predict how the men would do, you know, after all, you know, been a couple of cup games and some friendlies. So it's hard to pick when there's no form.
The coaching's easy, mate. This stuff's the hard stuff. Trying to pick who's going to do well.
I reckon I'll side with you too, Mark. I reckon I go for West Adelaide due to the quality and caliber of player they have. And after what was probably a very disappointing season for them last year, I think they'll definitely come good for 2024. To the men's league, starting in State League 2, Gawler Eagles versus Pontian Eagles, the Eagle Derby, I guess you could call it in a way.
like that, the Eagle Derby.
I will go for Pontian.
Yeah, I think I'm going Pontian as well. Their form at the moment, like I said earlier, I think they're becoming a bit of a dark horse, or a dark eagle. I'm not sure how you do that, but... I'm going with Pontians.
I'm going to go with Pontians as well. I think this could be a big one, especially if Gawler are losing that much to a team that's probably more on their level, like Seaford. See them versus a top team like Pontian. I think it's could get a bit nasty in the goals tally, at least. Probably not the card one. But.
Yeah, Pontian for me as well. I mean, I think Gawler will be down towards the bottom half of the table anyway, and Pontian have surprised us a little bit, so I'm going to go for Pontian.
Cove FC versus Modbury Vista. It's a pretty hard one to pick, but I reckon I'll go for Cove at home.
Yeah, look, on a Friday night, up on the top of the hill, I have to go with Cove, especially if some of their players are back as well. I'm going to go with the home win.
I reckon I'll agree as well. I think they're going to be back and they're going to be full of confidence after their start to the season. I think they're just going to keep the train rolling on.
Yep, cool for me too. They're on a bit of a roll. I know we're only two games in, but they also have their cup game as well. So there are three competitive matches in and they're on a wee bit of a roll. So I'll back Cove.
I'll just say now, Charlie Bowman, there's your motivation, mate. I know he listens in and he said he wanted some motivation, so... There's his motivation.
There's your motivation. Cove's going to beat you. We all think that.
He wanted me to put them lower in the predictions so that he could put that up on the wall. use as motivation for his boys. So there you go, Charlie.
Adelaide Uni versus Mount Barker United, right next to the zoo as well.
Well, so be careful, mate. Don't go in that zoo, mate. They might not let you out.
Yeah, well, David called me an animal last week, so.
We need some context. That was during a football game, right?
we'll let the audience decide that.
Who's going first of this, Alessio? Are you going to go first?
Well, we know he's going to pick Barker. So
I was going to say, I wonder what he's going to pick.
Well, we've got to stop the rot sometime soon, and I hope it's every week if it's after the week like that. So I'm going to say draw, though, again. Every big team, I think it's probably hard to get a win over them, and another one that's going to be depleted somewhat. I've seen there's no Peter Mercurio in the first few games as well for Adelaide Uni, so I'm not sure if he's got a long-term injury, but boy, do I hope he doesn't come back this week. I'm going to go for a draw.
Uni at home, yeah. Sorry, Alex, yeah.
Uni for me too.
Use that as motivation, Alessio. Prove us all wrong, mate.
Port Adelaide versus Northern Demons. At Port Adelaide, I should say. I'll go for Northern Demons after recent form.
I only got a draw in this one. I think I saw a little bit from Port Adelaide that I wasn't expecting, and they were missing Kaka Dembele as well in that game, so that's a big miss for them. I kind of think that maybe Northern Demons have had quite a lot of support at home so far. So maybe, and then one of their first away games on a grass pitch as well could be a bit difficult for them after their first few games being an artificial. So I'm going to give Port the win at home.
I'm actually going to agree with you, Alessio. I fancy Port for this one. Northern Demons have, well, they haven't dropped league points yet. Oh, they've had a draw and a win, haven't they? But is it a draw and a win they've had?
Yeah.
Yeah, drawing a win. But I think they've played both those games at home, haven't they? So I don't like to always back the team that's up higher on the table, so I'm going to go for Port in this. I agree with you, Alessio.
I'm going to sit on the fence. Both former teams. I normally pick with my heart, so I'm going to go just sit on the fence, go a draw, and yeah, go from there.
Up next in State League 2 is a Southern derby between Seaford Rangers and Noarlunga United. I will go for Seaford.
I would agree with you. I don't fancy Noarlunga at all. Sorry, Noarlunga. I'm going to go for Seaford as well.
I'll go with it as well. Hopefully that red card doesn't affect them too much, but finally they're scoring freely and I think they're going to do okay in that middle part of the table. So I'm going to give it to Seaford as well.
Yeah, look, playing in a couple of these, I would have to say in current form and things like that, you've got to go Seaford at home as well on the artificial. I'll go with Seaford, but it will be a lot closer. I think it might be closer than what people would anticipate. We all expect, obviously, Noarlunga not to do as well this year, but it will be a close being a derby. It's always up for it, and there'll be a few cards as well.
And the final game for State League 2, Adelaide Hills Hawks versus Eastern United at the Hawks Nest. I reckon I'll go Eastern.
I think it's going to be a lot closer than probably people expect. They do play somewhat of a long ball game sometimes, Eastern United, and I think both these teams probably got big target men up top with Alexander Markaj, Nathan Elliott now, so it's going to be quite a similar sort of play style. They've obviously got some quality players in Eastern United side as well that they've signed, so I think they could be the ones to take it over the line, but I'm going to go for an Eastern win, but it's going to be very close. I'm going to say like a 2-1 or something like that. I don't think they'll find it as easy as they have in the past, probably.
I think it'll be quite close as well. I'll go for a draw in this one. I think both sides have got fairly leaky defences, so I think a draw, but I think it'll be like a 3-3 draw or something. So, yeah, draw. Points shared.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Eastern, but Hoskins to score for Hills.
On to State League 1, West Torrens Burkalla versus Salisbury United. Again, going off current form, I'll go for Salisbury United.
That's at Jack Smith Park as well. So it's going to be a tough one on artificial away from home, first one of the year for Salisbury. I'm going to go with draw.
Yeah, very tough one to pick as well. I think I'm going to go for a draw as well. Burkalla finally got some of their scoring underway in the second round this season. So I think they don't have trouble putting it in the net, but they've had trouble keeping it out, especially at vital times, coming close against Adelaide Victory, and obviously that 91st minute equaliser for West Adelaide last week. So I'm going to go for a draw as well.
I'm going to back Salisbury United. I still fancy them in this league. They're scoring freely enough. They've got 5 goals in their first 2 games, and they're fairly tight at the back. They've conceded 2. And this game's down at Jack Smith Park, did we say, down at Bracuilla, is it?
Yeah.
That's the only thing that throws a little bit of doubt in my mind. But no, I think I'll stick with Salisbury United to continue their form. So they'll win.
Cumberland United versus Fulham United. I'll go Fulham.
You don't give much away other than just the results there, do you?
I'm a simple man.
Yes. Well, I know that.
I'm going to go for Fulham as well, unsurprisingly. But I think it'll be a tighter game than expected as well. They're always going to be tough to play at Cumberland at home. I'm going to say it'll be like a 3-1 maybe for Fulham.
I'll go Fulham as well. Yep, I'm a simple man. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, I think Fulham as well. Just purely, Raji's not back for Cumberland for a while. He's still out. I have Harley Jett should be back this week. But I'm not sure about Wooding and Sherwin at this stage, so I'm going to go for Fulham.
We've already had the Eagles derby in State League 2. Now we have the Snake derby between Adelaide Ammonia Cobras and Vipers FC. David, we actually covered this game last year, if you remember, except it was the home leg at Vipers, and it was pretty entertaining.
Yeah, I don't remember that. When was that?
We did a doubleheader at
Angle Park,
Adelaide Olympic. Yeah.
Yeah, and yeah, yeah.
Played Sturt right after.
Yeah, yeah. No, I do remember it now. I just had a bit of a mental blank. Yeah, that's it's funny that. Yeah, so, so Vipers. Nah, I don't fancy them, to be honest. This is a hard one, isn't it? I immediately think Vipers. I don't fancy them, and then I think Cobras. I don't fancy them either. Can I pick them both to lose? Doesn't work that way, does it? A draw. I'll pick a draw for this one.
Game abandoned, maybe?
Two sides that can't score, isn't it? Nil-nil draw.
To lose, then maybe you can game abandoned like Seaford.
I'll pick a nil-nil draw.
I'm going to give Cobras the win on this one. I think they're going to finally click this season, and Vipers, we picked them to be quite low in the table, so I think Cobras are finally going to get their confidence back this week with a win here.
I'm in agreement with you, Alessio. I think it'll kickstart their season. So I'm going Cobras as well.
I just looked it up, and apparently a Cobra's venom is more toxic than a viper. So,
are you basing your tip on the how potent the venom is?
Oh, absolutely. Again, some more birds. Adelaide Blue Eagles versus Playford City. A repeat of the cup round where Blue Eagles came out 1-0 winners, again also at Marden, but it is pretty tough, to be fair. I'll go a draw.
Yeah, two sides on showing a little bit of form in these early rounds, isn't it? So that is a difficult one to pick as well. I can see Blue Eagles have scored 6 goals in their first 2 games and play for 4, so they're both scoring really enough, aren't they? How do you pick that one? I don't know. I'll go draw, and that'll be another 3-3 draw. There you go. High scoring draw.
I was going to agree with you with the draw there. I think if it was at Playford, that I would have probably tipped them to reverse that cup round fixture. But since it's at Blue Eagles, I reckon I'm going to give it a draw as well.
Jeez, you guys are courageous and all sitting on the fence, aren't you? Gee whiz. However, I'm going to join you. I can't pick a winner. The fence as well.
Adelaide Victory versus Sturt Lions at the old Enfield ground of Victory's home. I'll go Sturt.
It's another tough one, I think, to call this one. It's both of them have had decent starts to the season. Adelaide Victory, obviously, they're doing well at home, beating a team like West Torrens Bacala, but obviously they lost as well to Blue Eagles, and maybe they were a bit closer to Blue Eagles than what Sturt were. I think it's not going to be as one-sided as some people might expect. I'm going to go for a draw in this one as well.
Yeah, close game. I think hard to predict as well, but I'm going to go for what is maybe an upset and say Sturt to win. And I base that on nothing more than they haven't had a win yet. And I think it's their vibes. And I think I think it, you know, eventually you've got to get your first win, and three games in, that's when the pressure starts to build, doesn't it? So I'll pick starting this one for no reason other than I think it's for no reason really.
I'm going to have to go right. Time with the result they had last week at home. I'm going to go. I'd like to see Sturt get the win, but I think victory at home.
Only the most informed opinions on this show. to the MPL, to Alessio, the game.
Sorry, on, yeah, my Strikers in West Adelaide.
Oh, yep, I forgot them. Apologies. Western Strikers versus West Adelaide, the final game for State League One. I'll go West Adelaide.
Well, I'm just on the fence. I'm going to say a draw. It's a tough place to go, as we've seen. Carnegie Reserve. West Adelaide have had probably a stuttering start so far. Two draws. And I reckon they're going to continue that streak and get a third one here.
I'm going to go with West Adelaide to win this one, based on the same sort of feelings I have for the Sturt one that we predicted a moment ago. And that's that, you know, they'll want to get their first win. They'll have that eagerness, or they should have that eagerness, to try and get points on the board. So I think they'll have motivation to get something out of this. So I'll back West Adelaide here.
I'm actually going to go West Adelaide as well, only on the fact that Strikers may have lost their goalkeeper. He went off injured last week. I'm not sure as to how well he's going to pull through, if he's going to be ready in time. If Seth's not available, they've got a good number two in Kieran Wanderer, but I'm not sure how well he's going to go up against the likes of a West Adelaide first start in the league. If he starts, if Seth doesn't come through. So if Seth's not playing, I'm going to go with the West Adelaide win.
On to MPL. We've got quite a few games on the Friday night. Alessio, the one you will be covering at Adelaide Croatia Raiders versus Adelaide Olympic.
And you guys are excited. What are you covering this weekend?
Somewhat.
Jeez, you guys are good. I don't normally decide till like Thursday.
Yeah, I just look at the ones that don't clash with my games and then just try to put my name in there first.
So basically anything on a Friday for Alessio.
Yeah.
I'll go Croatia Raiders.
Down south, so.
Yeah, I'm going to give Croatia the win here. This is going to be a big tester for Adelaide Olympic to go away to a place like this to try and regain some form at the start of their season, and I think it's going to end in a bit of misery. If one of my mates, Anthony Costa, comes back, as he's told me, he might get some minutes off the bench. I'm going to tip into score if he does, because I think Adelaide Olympic have been shipping a few goals recently, and I think if there's some gaps for him to come on to, going to be a big win for Adelaide Croatia in front of their home support.
Yeah, I'd agree with you, Croatia Raiders, to win this based on what I saw on Saturday afternoon with you, Seb, when we were doing the game up there at Klemzig against Metro Stars. Croatia Raiders, they just look good. They'd be bitterly disappointed not to have got something out of that game, and they've shown that they can mix it with the big boys in this league, and they looked good all through last year in their promotion campaign. So an Olympic just haven't got the form just now for me, so I'm going to go with Adelaide Croatia Raiders for the win in this one.
Can I just pick the team that I played for in this one, because I'll get right with both of them? So I played for both clubs, but Raiders, I'll go with Raiders on this one.
Modbury Jets versus Croydon also on that Friday night. I reckon, especially being at Modbury, Modbury will take the win on that one. Only two rounds last weekend. That pitch really hurts your ankles if you're not used to it either way. It's terrible.
Yeah, I saw a kid's TikTok rating the pitch as well, and he said it kind of feels like it almost always off balance or something.
There's a slight, I can't think of how to explain it. There's something to it which isn't completely flat, and it definitely hurts your ankles.
Maybe that's why we saw Hamish McCabe trying to limp off an injury the other week as well, Seb. But it's going to be another interesting game. Croydon, obviously, surprise winners last week. But Modbury Jets have been scoring quite freely in comparison, and I think they're going to get the job done at home. They had a good support last time we were out there in round one, and they're really going to be desperate to get a win. And if they got Jordan O'Doherty starting, I think he's going to start getting some form and really creating some havoc in this league.
Part of me fancies Croydon to win this based on their upset win last week. But I think the reality is that Modbury Jets are scoring freely. I think you just said that, Alessio, did you? They've got no problem scoring goals. They've got about 8 goals in their 2 games, I think, haven't they, in their first 2 games this year? Maybe 7 goals, actually. So I'm going to pick Modbury at home. Modbury at home, I'll pick them.
Yeah, look, they're turning Jet Park, or whatever it's called, Smith Park and Stadium, sorry, into a bit of a what they used to have as a Friday night fortress. So it was always tough going there on a Friday night. So Modbury for me over Croydon.
Next game is between Campbelltown City and Metro Stars, the Australia Cup rematch. But I'll go Campbelltown.
I'll keep it simple. I actually am going to go with Metro in the fact that Woodlands isn't playing. They're playing the number 2 keeper. A big game for him. He might be a good keeper. I've only seen him very briefly, but he is relatively young. So just on that fact alone, I'm going to go with Metro.
I still fancy Campbelltown to do well this year.
So do I. But
yeah. Yeah. So this is a hard one to predict as well, isn't it? I still fancy Campbelltown to do well this year, but are they going to bounce back from the surprise defeat to Croydon last week? Or are they going to be rattled by that to the point where Metro Stars roll over them? I don't know. I'm going to go Metro Stars win. They're really hard to predict. I'll just go for a Metro Stars win in this one. Campbelltown to drop down a couple of spots as a result of being beaten by Metro Stars, but to then rebound and come through with the goods as the season progresses.
I'm going to go with Campbelltown, bit against the grain against both your predictions, but I think a team after losing such a surprise game like that and with all the chips down, I reckon that Matriciani is going to have them real revving up for this one in front of their home support as well. They always get good crowds there as well, and I'm looking forward to see some more Malisi and Murray magic.
Back to the paddocks for the second week in the row. Para Hills Knights versus Adelaide United. Riley Stamm playing against his former side. David, we'll go to his biggest fan on this one.
Yeah, thanks. I'm going to pick Para Hills for this. I think Adelaide United are just out of form a little bit just now. Para Hills lost last weekend, obviously, to Adelaide City, but they showed great character in that match. And I think they were playing against an Adelaide City side that were on their game. So I'll go Para Hills Knights to win this one.
Yeah, I'm sticking with Para Hills on this one as well, just purely based off the fact that Adelaide United are just in that transition. They're still those young players are still learning their roles and things like that. So I think a Para Hills win at home.
Yeah, 3 Para Hills wins, I reckon that is. I've been really disappointed to see some of the keeping and defensive mistakes from Adelaide United trying to force their way, playing out the back. And I think until they can get that fixed, they're not going to have the best of starts in this season, at least.
Yep, I reckon I'll agree with Para Hills Knights too, especially after their game last week, where they definitely showed a good fight back against a strong Adelaide City. The final game in the NPL for the weekend, Adelaide Comets versus Adelaide City. I think if you tried to put this one before the season begun, you probably would have said City. But at current form, I reckon it's much, much harder to predict. But I'd go Comets.
I'm going to go a draw on this one. I saw them, obviously, we're watching Comets against South, and some of the players they were able to bring off the bench who would normally be starting in that side, you sort of go, wow, there's a bit there. Like, they've got depth in that squad. So I'm going to go a draw at Service FM for Comets. I just think that it will probably be pretty level. So a draw.
I'm gonna give it to Adelaide City. I reckon they're going to have that elite mentality. The last time they played them at that ground as well, or one of the previous times, that grand final might have the demons over Adelaide Comets. I think as well, both sides are probably yet to reach their full potential. I remember there was a couple of subs in that Adelaide City game in a dull period where Parry was almost getting on top of them there. They've still got a few things to work on, Adelaide City, but I just think that once those wide players can get that freedom, that Peter Ricott, and Lewis Larry Latanzio. I think it's going to be a very dangerous game for them, and I'm going to give Adelaide City the tip on this one.
I'm with you, Alessio. Adelaide City, for me, looked very good when we watched them on Friday night. So I'm going to back Adelaide City to win this. Don't forget that Comets are top, but have played two sides down at the bottom. I think they've played Adelaide Olympic, are 10th, and South Adelaide are 12th. So they've played two. Currently, we're only two games in, I get that. But they've played two sides that they probably should have beaten anyway. And they're top of the table because of that. So I think reality will bite this weekend for them, and Adelaide City will dismiss them. Sorry, Comets.
FK Beograd versus South Adelaide. I'll go with FK Beograd, though.
At home, if FK Beograd can get off to the right start and actually start on time, then I'm going with FK Beograd again this week to beat South. Even if JJ is available, it's a big risk starting him, coming back from such a serious injury where he's been in a moon boot for the last 2 weeks. So I'm just not sure South will... I think South will probably start their season after the cup round once they've got the likes of JJ back, and obviously they are still missing a couple of players. So I'm going to go with FK Beograd.
Same with me, FK Beograd. Friday nights there at Frank Mitchell Park. They had a bit of an uneasy run there last season. I remember they had like 5 losses in a row every time I would watch the game from there. But I think they're going to get it in front of their home team as well. After that positive confidence boost last week, I think they're going to beat South Adelaide there. And it's going to be a very tough start to the season for South Adelaide.
I've heard you've been banned from there on a Friday night this year because of that run last year.
I'm going to back FK Beograd as well. South Adelaide, for me, obviously don't have the form required to convince me that they are going to do anything other than lose to FK Beograd at the weekend. And I get what you're saying about missing JJ Rideout up front, but I'm looking at their goal tally now, and they've conceded 9 goals in those first 2 games. So I don't think the problem is necessarily just that they're missing something up front. There's something not right at the back either. So FK Beograd to win that, and to win it convincingly.
Well, that's all the fixtures for the upcoming weekend, and pretty much all from us. But Mark, we have a little thing to talk about quickly, a little announcement about what do you call it, a player, a team of the year sort of thing we're going to do?
Yeah, well, we might as well. That's what all good football podcasts do, is they put their heads together at the end of the year. So the great minds that are on this podcast, we'll put our heads together, and towards the end of the season, we'll come up with a team of the year. So it'll be a starting 11 for the NPL. We are working towards sponsorship for the team of the year. So if anyone out there listening wants to jump on board, reach out to me and we'll have a discussion. And also, obviously, if anyone wants to reach out about sponsoring the podcast in general, also reach out to me and have that discussion. And obviously, so on top of that, we'll do a team of the year, which we'll announce obviously at the end of the season. But we'll also have the One Game at a Time podcast. We'll have our best and fairest. So between all us comms, we're doing a 3-2-1 each week for each game. So I'll pick a game, Seb will pick a game, and Alessio and Dave will pick games that we watch each weekend, and we'll basically pick our 3-2-1, and then obviously we all know how that works, and the player with the most votes at the end of the season will win the One Game at a Time podcast best and fairest for the season.
Absolutely, very exciting. I think we'll do a special episode just counting up the votes right at the end of the year to make it extra exciting. our own little celebration of football.
Why not?
Other than that, that's pretty much all from us for this week. Stay tuned as well for a special WNPL preview podcast coming sometime this week. We'll go through all the teams in the WNPL and the WSL as that season starts to approach. But other than that, thank you, gentlemen, for joining me for this week. And we'll look forward to next week. To be confirmed.
Ah, well, you had some big names for us.
Maybe.
Awesome. That's what we like. That's what we want to hear. Big names for the podcast.
Some current WNPL players will be involved.
Oh, fantastic.
So completely non-biased as well.
I'm sure. Not like having Mount Alessio pick Mount Barker to win or draw every week.
Nothing wrong with that.
But yeah, thank you, gentlemen, for joining me for this week. And we'll be with you again next week for another episode.
Cheers for having us.
Thanks, mate.
Yeah. Cheers.